say hunker down.
Hunker down.
Hunker down, y'all.
Hunker down.
Hunker down.
Hunker down.
Hunker down.
Hunker down.
Hey y'all, welcome to the Hunker Downcast, episode number 7, The Hunk Awakens. We are here at the Irish Doghouse in beautiful downtown Mid-City with Alli.
Hey everybody.
And Jeff Pants, Skooks, the man of many names.
I haven't awakened yet.
You haven't?
No, you can check with me later.
You might as well just stay asleep because it's pretty late then. Yeah. How is everybody doing? Alli, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. It's Thursday night, right?
It is
only one more day.
For a few more hours, anyway.
This whole week I've felt very unstuck in time. I guess because it's the first full week back and, you know, just had a hard time.
You haven't adjusted to the 20... Did you Y2K out on us, or is it like something that you need to...
No, I mean, I Star Wars'd out over the new year, so that was
fun. Hell yeah.
But technically I'm on jury duty this week, although I don't have to, they postponed it and I don't have to go in until Monday.
Whoa. So. Wow. It's amazing to me that you have to go in at all.
This is actually breaking news to me now. We talked for like an hour or so before we did this and I didn't know you had jury duty.
I have jury duty.
Wow.
Yeah. At civil district court.
Civil.
Yep.
Okay. So the boring kind.
Yeah. Like, no, I'm actually... This is how much of a nerd I am. I am super excited. I really want to get put on a jury. Also because that's the only way you get paid. And I don't want to sit in
like
a room all day. Yeah, it's $25.
They cover your parking.
Right.
So. And you're ready to deal out some Alli brand of justice on somebody.
Absolutely.
Hell yeah.
I want to get put on a... I don't know what... I should know this. I mean, I guess it's like, what, contract disputes and stuff? I mean,
torts.
Yeah.
The torts awakened.
The tortfeasors awakened. Yes. Oh, I'm so pumped. I really, I've wanted to be on a jury, or at least do jury duty for my whole adult life.
Are you shitting me?
This is the first time I've been called.
That is odd.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
So.
That is a civic.
Happy 2016.
Hey, congratulations on that.
It's like saying I've wanted to, you know, renew my driver's license my whole life. It's like this thing that you basically have to do that. Alli wants to do.
Well, 16-year-olds get really pumped about getting... although not anymore. I guess the millennials don't like it. But when I was 16, I was really excited to get my driver's license.
The millennials don't like it?
They're not driving anymore.
Oh, it's like having a TV or a microwave or eating meat.
I have wanted to...
Yeah.
I have wanted to renew my brake tag for 6 years.
Oh, shit. I need to do that, too.
6 years now. I put it... Yeah, so...
Okay.
I can't wait. I can't wait to do that.
Wait, you have to get a back window first.
Right. I have
and
to have
not a basket woven duct tape
I need
job.
A street legal vehicle, so if anybody would like to donate one, then I can go ahead and get my brake
just
tag.
Just get the
but
window.
Until then.
You don't need a whole new vehicle.
No, they can't. That window is a long saga.
The car is totaled because it's got a broken window?
Well, it's just no one can find the specific piece of glass that will fit that window.
Oh, well, you got to go to the junkyard, bro.
I've been to the junkyard.
You have?
Yeah, and I've had...
Pull apart
I've
out
had,
there and...
Not only that, but I've had mechanics who know the junkyard and know the several junkyards to call work as my agent to find the specific piece of glass that fits that 20-year-old car. Not a single one.
It's so, wait, you have
I think
like
you need
a...
to just stalk the remaining owners of this car, of your car, in the city, because I've seen them. I know they're out
Those
there.
Cars are everywhere.
And steal their window.
Why don't I just take the car?
Whoa. Oh, okay. That
would make more sense.
Maybe they have a seat that's not just a loose pile of foam.
Would you like, if I could trade it, maybe with like a number two draft choice from New York, and I could take their car, and that would be the thing.
Is that a rare Tercel? Because I know they're, is that particularly type of Tercel
it's,
rare? Like,
no,
do you have one from that year, make and model, that has a variant on it or something?
No, it's...
That makes
it's
the window weird?
It's a 1994 Toyota Tercel.
Oh, those have got to be out there.
It's old enough to drink.
I have to question your mechanic.
Well, it's not the only... I mean, these are multiple sources that we've consulted, so...
I'm going to investigate this. I'm going to look on the Google.
Okay. Anybody out there listening wants to help,
How are you? So that's, we don't even have to round table you. That's how you're doing. You're looking for a break. Anything going on in your life that?
No, I was going to tell Alli that, you know, the last time I had jury duty was, it was actually 9/11.
What?
Like, I was in jury duty on 9/11.
Are you serious?
Yeah, it was kind of awesome because I didn't have to do jury duty that day. Like, we came in and 9/11 happened and then they let us go. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
Based on shit's going down.
Right, because the next place the terrorists were coming was obviously going to be Orleans Parish Criminal Court, because that's what would happen next, of course.
Sure.
And so we had to go
home. They would strike us. Yeah. They would strike us where it hurts.
Can never be too careful.
Yeah, never. But
I was
still in high school back then. So.
Okay.
Oh, wow. We could just we almost slipped into a
Where were you on
9/11 episode?
What was it? All
right. Let's not do that one.
Yep.
Let's see. I got a bathtub this week, and I'm doing pretty good. I'm ready to start.
Got a bathtub.
I bought a bathtub.
It's almost like I got a break tag.
I'm really jealous, man. True. Where the Irish doghouse is a bathless apartment. We don't. We only have shower stalls in here, even though we have two bathrooms.
How do you live?
I felt godless for a while, you know, like a man without a god.
If you're a bath man, you gotta have baths.
I filled it up. I bought a claw foot from a guy uptown. Uh-huh. It's pink. It's very hard to move. It's like a cast iron skillet, except the size of a bathtub. And my buddy Josh Murphy, who is our sponsor of the Hunker Downcast, because he builds it better.
With his company.
Magnolia Builders.
There you go.
We'll talk about them a little bit later.
Okay.
We might owe them a logo on the website.
You have a Magnolia built bathtub? You might have to NASCAR.
I have a Magnolia installed bathtub. Mm. And he told me that plumbers back in the day used to carry the bathtubs on their back like a turtle. And I was like, that is bullshit. There is no way anyone is
not possible.
Did he demonstrate this technique for
you? Fuck no.
Oh.
In fact, you know, because...
Well, that's not very historical renovation-y. That's not in the spirit of...
Well, I think it's historical fiction.
Oh, okay.
That they actually did that.
Right.
I don't know. Well, I'll the Google that also.
Okay.
Because I don't think it happens.
But you're a bath man. Now, explain to me, like, do you take a bath every night? Is that what
No. I don't know if you want to go down this rabbit hole.
Define a bath man.
But I take a bath on Wednesdays and Sundays, and there's a caveat, when spiritually necessary.
Okay.
And I could do it at any day if it's spiritually necessary.
So it's a baptismal as well.
Yeah, I try and, you know, just go on Wednesdays and Sundays. But okay. If I'm having a really bad day or, like, something's happened that I feel as though I need a bath, I'm not committing any sins by taking one on an off day, a Tuesday or a Thursday. I can also take them on holidays like Christmas.
Right.
So
there's Palm Sunday. There's sins and holidays involved in your bath routine?
It's part of my religion, yes.
Okay.
My spirituality, I guess. Yeah. Baths are part of it.
Baths are gross. I just wanted to say for the record.
The heat kills any bacteria.
They're just gross.
The heat and soap.
You're trying to get clean.
Kills any bacteria.
Just blast the crap off of you with a very powerful...
It's more like a chore. Taking a shower is more like a chore.
Everything's a chore.
No, the bath is not. The bath is almost womb-like.
Wow.
So that you don't have to even worry about any problems.
No, I'm out. Mm. You said the magic W word that I hate.
Womb.
Oh! It's a terrible...
I feel like...
I don't know. It sounds comforting to me.
We're getting into some real weird areas with the both of you.
Let's talk about the news, Jeff.
Damn it. We were on a roll. Now we're going to bring the unfunny.
I'll talk about... Oh, no. We'll make this news funny.
All right. Well, what the hell is going on this week? Like Alli said, it's kind of... It's been a crazy week because everybody's just coming back from the new year and transitioning into Carnival. So we had those, like, 2 days where everybody kind of, like, did work, sort of, right? Like, you kind of went into work and were like, hey, well, things will happen.
What did I do those 2 days?
Yeah, see? It's like they didn't happen. That's
Monday and Tuesday?
Yeah.
Huh, I don't remember and anything now we're about those days, even though they were only 2 days ago.
And now we're right back into party time. So
I spent them watching Making a Murderer, so we'll get into that later.
What did I do Monday?
So the problem with that is that if you're looking for headlines, You're looking for the things that happened in those couple of days when everybody was kind of trying to pretend to be grown-ups.
Which could be when they slip stuff through, because everybody, it's like the Friday afternoon news release.
Yeah, that's why you got to watch.
Throw it out with the trash.
Yep. Sits out there.
Mm-hmm.
So I've jotted down a few things.
They don't get past Jeff, though.
Well, they do, actually. But I've jotted down a few things. John Bel Edwards named several of his officials that he's going to put in charge of different things. He named some people to the Bessie board. He named most, I think, newsworthy, I think, was his naming of the Department of Health and Hospitals head,
mm-hmm.
who is a doctor from the New Orleans area named Rebecca Gee or G. Is it Gee?
I don't know. Let's go with G.
Okay.
G-E-E is how it's spelled.
Oh, that seems like G.
Okay, well, we'll go with that, and then we'll be corrected, and we'll feel bad about ourselves.
Yeah, there was an Advocate article today by Mark Ballard. Thank you, Mark, for this article, which quotes extensively Benjamin Clapper, the director of Louisiana Right to Life, and confirmed hate group leader Reverend Gene Mills from the Louisiana fucking Family Forum, which is the worst group, and I really wish that people would stop calling this dude to get quotes, because he's the worst.
I feel that way about Lewis from Jackson Square. He's your Lewis. He's just the hateful guy that they call to get bullshit.
Yeah, I mean, that's Gene Mills in Louisiana politics, and Gene Mills has way more power than Gene Mills deserves to have in state
absolutely.
Politics.
Absolutely. He's a...
So that's probably going to change a little bit now with the new administration. It's, good. It's right. Kind of interesting.
Well, this whole article quoting Clapper and Mills is like all about how pissed they are, and except they don't want to say right out that they're pissed about this appointment of Dr. G. They're just asking questions.
Oh, they're asking questions.
Questions have been raised.
Questions have been raised.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're the most pro-life state in the nation, and, you know, John Bel Edwards is being... clandestine about an aggressive advocate for the abortion position. So, fuck you, Gene Mills.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not endorsing you.
Okay.
But his hatred is definitely making me on board with this appointment of Dr. G for DHH Secretary. I'm all in.
Yeah. And the reason I thought this was all newsworthy is I'm looking for ways to be somewhat optimistic about the incoming administration.
You're very optimistic.
I am actually pretty high on John Bel Edwards.
You're the most optimistic I've seen you about any single politician in my lifetime.
And as we
eventually this will sour, I'm sure.
Oh, it'll change. And I'll tell you. I mean,
you kind of hating on Obama a few years back too. You're starting to hate on him. Am I imagining that?
I'm still not a fan of Obama.
You've never been.
No, I never have been on. I've never been.
Okay.
But
damn, that says a lot for John Bel Edwards then.
Well, it's no.
Although, of course, it's a blank slate.
I'm talking.
And it's an expectations game.
Yeah, I'm
sure he's going to disappoint you.
No, that's
let's look at this point in the future and think. At one point, Jeff endorsed and was optimistic about John Bel Edwards.
Well, what I think about, you're painting it in such a strange way.
You're going to get pissed off at some point and be like, he's a fucking dumbass, and then we're going to have you on record, which is great because
what I'm saying is I'm optimistic about the practical things that this administration can get done and probably will get done. I don't think that we're going to have super trains to Baton Rouge. I don't think that we're going to have, you know, free school for everybody anymore. I mean,
Guantanamo Bay.
I don't think that we're going to have world peace.
Are we going to take the state flag of Texaco off the Capitol building?
No.
Okay.
So that's not going to happen either. Right. My prediction for 2016 is we're not going to save the Louisiana coast. You know, that's just not going to happen. So I can be very pessimistic about it if you want me to. But
if the river overflows, that would help.
That'd save the coast. Right. That's what's
Fuck the cities, but the coast would be okay. Mm-hmm. Which might be. Do you have anything else left to say?
Oh, just to close that. And the other thing I wanted to mention about the DHH appointee is that she confirmed that they are definitely going to take the Medicaid expansion on either day one or day two.
All right.
Of the administration, like Yay! They promised they would. So that's some good news there.
That's fantastic.
In the future, we will have, you know, some complaints about the administration as soon as they take office, probably. But for now, we're optimistic.
Well, I do want to say one more thing, is that she's a renowned expert and on healthy births and maternal health. And Louisiana has terrible maternal health outcomes right now. So if she's able to make some good headway on that, that'll be great for the ladies. Yay!
I could say something about Minkle's, a story she told me last night about childbirth defects, but I won't get into that.
Yeah, okay.
I'm just letting her know. It might have been a bad month to switch up on that.
I almost forgot about that. Yeah, that may, let's not bring that up.
Right, we won't. We won't. That's between us and Minkles. Yes.
Okay, so that's the headlines this week are just not that exciting.
Well, the river is about to overflow.
All right, so that's the one you hinted at a little while
ago. Yeah, we should segue into that. It's one way to save the coast.
The Mississippi River is extremely high for January. And it's almost at flood stage at the Carrollton gauge, which is the one they always tell you about.
Yeah, that's the one, man. When it gets world to 17, famous Carrollton gauge.
When it gets to 17 feet, they open
the bonnet. The tourists go there and they take the pictures by the Carrollton gauge. It's all very nice.
I never go up there.
Yeah, I don't know where it's at.
It's at the
flood. I just go up to the when I lived in Algiers, I would just go up to the levee and be like, oh my, you know what? The gauge I use is the steps out in front of the cathedral. And yeah, like what step it's up on.
Right.
And then I'd be like, wow, that shit is high.
Right. Yeah.
Also, out in front of Old Point Bar, when I used to live in Algiers Point, sometimes you could sit on the levee and like throw your empties into the river. And sometimes the river was like way far away and there was just no way you could.
Why would you throw things in the river?
It's stuff you do when you're drunk and you're drinking on the levee, man. It's levy beers, man. It's a West Bank thing you wouldn't understand.
I've had plenty of levy beers in my life. I never threw the bottles in the
river. On the East Bank?
Wait a minute. This year, after the Eagles game, after the Saints played the Eagles, Saints got the shit kicked out of them by the Philadelphia Eagles
this
year.
Yeah, that was an awful game.
You guys went out.
Fired coach.
You guys went out to the levy and threw a football into the river.
No, that was last year.
Was that last year?
Yeah.
I thought it was this year.
It was after the third game of the season last year.
Why do I have the Eagles game in my head?
And that don't even bring that video up to Jeremy Hebert because he doesn't realize that he talks with such a thick accent. And then he watched that video and he realizes that he calls a football a football. I heard the football in my hand. After the Saints lost for the third time in a row. I threw the football into the lake, you know, and he sounds like, you know, Cajun man. Everybody knows he sounds like Cajun man. He doesn't know he sounds like Cajun man.
He sounds like the guys on Swamp People.
He was raised out in Houma and Lafourche and Terrebonne, so when he hears a Cajun accent, no, he hears like legit south of Terrebonne, can't understand what the fuck they're saying, Cajuns.
Yeah.
So to them... To him, those people have the Cajun accents, and he is borderline normal.
Well, okay, I wrote it down. I'm putting this video in the show notes.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely. It's out there.
So what they did...
It also has a little bit of a Houses of the Holy Led Zeppelin cover feel to it, because we're all kind of standing on rocks out by the river.
This was a ceremony designed to... throw away the evil spirits that were plaguing the Saints at some point.
It was
either this year or last year.
Some Terrebonne hoodoo witchery.
Yeah.
You know, because he's from out there, so he's he believes in like possum tails and nutria teeth and stuff like that. I know he listens to the podcast while he does his paintings, so that's why I'm fucking with
him. So we threw a football into the river.
Yeah, he threw a football. Mr. Nolier than thou also.
Which was really low at the time. And I think this may have been the same day
and
that
the football
you saw a
drifted
dude
back.
Swimming in the river. Was that
no,
the same
no,
day?
That was a different day.
Shit!
It was a different day.
All right, so...
That was after the Nolier Than Thou contest. Okay. We went to that, and then we went and saw that bizarre... Which was entertaining.
Yeah.
You know, it was a very slow-paced show of a guy have a confrontation in the river with boats... Coast Guard, with there was like police on the riverbank fucking with them. It was fun.
Okay. But we remember about that day is there was a sandbar in the river because of how low
it was.
It
was definitely low that day.
It was very
day.
Low, and now it's extremely high. And what's interesting to me about this is, it's first of all, it's never been this high in January. And people can blame all sorts of things. You can blame the El Nino, or you can blame, you know, the fact of global warming, or the weird-ass winter we've had.
Uptown construction.
Probably can't blame the uptown construction.
It's right. Mitch's fault.
Mitch. It's probably Mitch and Obama.
We didn't have a high river before until the mayor said something about it.
Right. But the... So they're going to open Bonnie Carey, and they're going to open it all the way, which they never do, and they've only opened it like 10 times. So they're probably going to open more games. I mean,
every year it seems like they do something that they've never done before.
That, right. So this is like a thing that they...
But they have done them before.
Right, but they don't...
10 times they've done it, so it's not a big deal.
It feels to me like...
Morganza, they've only opened once or twice.
Yeah.
So that would be a big deal.
And it feels like...
And they didn't open it last year, or they opened it partially, or a few years back.
In 2011, they opened it.
They opened it partially.
And that was a big deal.
Because Morganza floods people's houses.
Yes.
It's a bigger deal. Bonnie Carey is a bigger...
Gives you good crawfish.
Bonnie Carey, like, messes up with the lake for a while, but Morganza will... There are people... who live in the Morganza Spillway.
Right.
So Morgan City is in the Morganza Spillway, I think.
No.
And they're levied.
They're protected. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they're not like in the...
Well, they are, but they're levied off. Some of them are.
I just think it's interesting because of how...
And I think if it gets a certain level of height, it doesn't matter. It overtops their levees.
Okay.
I think. Okay. Tim Ruppert... Holla back on that.
I just think it's interesting the degree to which this is, the severity of this, as opposed to the really casual attitude everybody has about
right,
it.
Right, because it's not severe. It's no big deal, Jeff.
Okay, maybe so. Maybe it's just me.
It is.
It's probably just me.
The river gets high every few years, and every now and then I remember asking Tim Ruppert about it once. I was like, hey, dude, I think I was walking the dog the other day, and I saw maybe water just bubbling up on the other side of the levee. And he was like, yeah, it happens a lot. You just go there, you look at it, and if it's no big deal, we just, you know, we put something. He was just like, hey, no problem.
Okay.
So I got it. I got it all taken care of.
Sam Boyle's
or
no
him
problem.
And his, you know, cronies over at the court.
His cronies. No. Yeah.
I mean, are you freaked out about them?
I'm not freaked out, but I'm just interested in it. And oh, okay. I just feel like it's like, I don't know. It just seems like a bigger deal to me than...
It is weird that it happened in January.
Yeah. But
yeah, the January part is what freaks me out.
Because there's more snow coming.
Absolutely. Well, this isn't a snow issue. It's been really mild up there. Mm-hmm. And so they've had a ton of rain.
Oh, that's what it is.
And so Missouri's actually been flooding like crazy. Yeah. So,
oh, maybe they'll get flooded and we'll be... saved. Maybe it'll all flood out up there.
I mean, it is flooding up there, but when that drains, it drains back into the Mississippi.
Oh. So. Thanks, Missouri.
Yeah.
Could have taken one from the team.
But what can happen in the next few months is there can be snow, and then there can be more snow melt, and there can
be a perfect storm.
Right, because it's snowing up there now. Right. So
now there will
now
be
they're
more.
Back to normal winter, maybe.
Okay.
Who knows?
One thing Tim did tell me when I was asking him about it back in 2011 was that once it breaks, it's done.
Okay. Like
there's no – you just have to wait till spring.
Okay, good.
Yeah, there's no
– cool.
Well, we'll watch out for that.
Yeah, you can't drop sandbags on it and shit like that.
No. Well, yeah. So on that note, that's – what else did we have this week? We had that and we had the river – do you want to talk about booties now, or do you want to take a break and then we come back and do that? Or
we should take a break.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're going to take a quick break.
What is the bumper music going to be?
We'll let the people find out when we... We'll be back.
You know what I want to talk about is booties. Booties.
Don't we all?
It was a gastropub, eatery, small plate, culinary, some shit.
It was like street food.
It was street food, but in a restaurant, which is pretty amazing.
I'm going to let
that's
him
a
back
concept.
In.
Right there. They came in.
Are you in a brain cloud again?
No, I'm just gone for a minute.
They beat us over the head with their concept. And they talked about how it was going to be a computer bar. And it was...
Oh, it was going to accept Bitcoin?
It wasn't going to accept Bitcoin?
I think it did accept Bitcoin.
Holy shit. Where is the Bitcoin? It's in a deduct box somewhere now. They're never going to find the Bitcoin deduct
box. It's in a Bahamian bank account, would be my guess.
That was at Booty's. Anyways, it became sort of
booty.
The central point of everyone's ire about Bywater gentrification.
Yeah.
Back in the day. And then it led...
Back in the day, didn't it open like 3 years ago?
I'm hyper nostalgic, man.
They brought it on themselves with this.
They absolutely did.
Went to like... You know, we are here to save the Bywater from the depths
themselves.
Of hell. Like, before we arrived in the Bywater, no cabs would come here.
Yeah,
there
they did
that
say
kind
that.
Of a thing. Until we renovated this particular building and turned it into a high concept cocktail bar. That was
with $20 street food.
I think the term they used for it was a blogstrant. Because you see where they...
I forgot about
no,
that.
No, this is totally true.
A blogstrant.
That is awful.
As we're talking, I'm actually...
Well, they closed this week. Oh, at first they closed indefinitely, and then like somebody was like, come on. And then I think I read a quote where the guy's like, yeah, we're closed.
Yeah.
And what I didn't realize at the time was that they're actually... the latest in a series of like sort of similar restaurants, concept restaurants in the Bywater that have been closing. There was also one that wasn't mentioned in the article named the Franklin, I think. It's across from Lost Love Lounge.
Okay.
That has a dubious sort of status. Like sometimes it's open, sometimes it's closed. It never really looks open and it is. The from what my friends tell me, it's really expensive and not very good. So there's like four or five restaurants there that are just they're dropping like flies.
Well, so like
and could it be the bubble bursting?
That was part of the thing with Booty's though, is that they didn't have a sign outside. Like it wasn't like you had to be like the cool people to go there.
Yeah, which is
so
I fart on that.
Right,
it's just like.
You farted in the
I went to Booty's once, and I used to live over there during a dark period of my life after my separation, and I never ate at Booty's once when I lived over there because it wasn't affordable. And where the places where I did eat were affordable places like Pizza Delicious, or as they call it over there in the Bywater, douchely, Pizza D, which I can talk about also what has happened there. And then I would eat at Pub Grub at Markey's. Which is the pubbest of pub grub. I mean, it's just standard fried shrimp with fries. And then I would every now and then eat at Lost Love Lounge, which had like some
Vietnamese food.
Yeah, it's a little on the heavy side, but still good. And a nice little atmosphere and a fun bar. And then,
Can I read to you a paragraph from...
No.
Yes, you're going to enjoy this. This
Are you
is
sure?
from,
we're
yes.
reading the internet to you guys.
This
now.
Is from
oh boy.
This is from Kevin Allman's original coverage of the
okay.
Booty's.
I changed my mind.
Okay.
Please read it.
This is in the Gambit. So
I love
this
you,
is
Kevin.
Just two paragraphs from this. This is in a way, Booty's will be a physical manifestation of their website's brand. Social media and online marketing will be a part of the concept, says Farrell, I guess is the guy.
Booty Boot.
Explaining that they've taken to calling it a quote-unquote blogstaurant. And then the remainder of the quote is, people see food as a type of content now. Like you can imagine hashtag content. They talk about it online. They take pictures of it. It becomes pixels before they've even enjoyed it. We want chefs to be tweeting and sharing the food from the kitchen. And we want people to convene at our restaurant like they do online now. And the guys' names are Vivian and Farrell. I'd have to backtrack from the it's one of the two that Kevin is quoting there. So there's that. And then just the
that
other...
That just sounds... In my head, that sounds like Mitt Romney is saying it to me. You know?
A little bit.
It's like...
It's
yeah.
like a robot or somebody who
this
has
burger,
no idea.
This burger's going viral in my mouth.
It's like...
I super like these fries, which is a tender thing.
It's Alli. Like when my mom calls something fat, as in P-H-A-T,
oh,
which
man.
No one has said since 1998.
Your mom says fat?
Like,
I like that.
She sometimes does that, or she... No, the best one was the other day. She called something whack, and then she corrected. And then she, no, it gets better. She corrected herself and then said Wizak.
Oh, like, she's right around 15 years ago.
I was
now.
Like, "What are you doing?"
She's that like, little.
Well, that's what you kids used to say.
That Snoop Dogg talk is one that I just won't let go of. I don't care how passe it ever gets. It's fun to say hizzle or snizzle.
I think that
his house. I love his house. I mean, I'm not letting go of that shit. I don't care how old I sound.
I think if you ask my mom who Snoop Dogg was, I don't know that she would know. Mm-hmm. So like that's what's just well, really just puts the cherry.
Maybe
on
she
top.
Knows him as Snoop Doggy Dog.
That's
his,
that could
his
be.
Previous, not Snoop Lion.
I think that the Booties guys would be so offended if they knew that you were comparing them to your mom, like just his relative level.
Yeah.
Of
well. Suck on that, Booties.
They sound,
my mom is awesome.
Those guys sound like somebody, like a person who you meet who's like super into you and tells you that, hey, you're the love of my life. I love everything about you. And then sort of like 6 months later is like, I don't know what I ever saw in that person. It's like, that's their concept. Like they went into that thing super into it and like, we're going to do this and we're going to do that and we're going to get married and we're going to have kids and we're going to, you
yeah.
know.
Chefs tweeting from the kitchen.
Yeah, right. Raise goats and stuff. And then all of a sudden I was like, you know what? I just don't know if I really feel for you anymore.
Right. So, and this is 2012, by the way.
That's when that
yeah.
all started?
So they came in 2012
God.
And saved wow. the Bywater. And in fact, there was like maybe a year or so later, there was an article where they talked about how before they arrived in 2012, cabs would not go to the Bywater. You know, cause it would be like, you know.
Only Ubers go. It's true. It's come full circle. Cabs don't go to the Bywater anymore either. Only Ubers.
Right. So I just found this while we were talking about it. And this is Todd Price's article about them closing. He has an update today where he says he's quoting someone named Greg Morris. Says, Greg Morris renovated and owns 800 Louisa Street, which is you know where they left. he says... I don't want people to think that the Bywater is going down because Booty's closed.
The Bywater's going... Well...
The Bywater is it, going down!
Is it a canary in the coal mine?
Is it about to rumble with,
were asking
with
about.
The Marini?
Well, going down, right. And that's,
yeah.
I think the real
going to set it off?
Indication
it's about to go down,
of right. whether there's a canary in the coal mine there is if Frady's closes. Like if Frady's gets closed and gets made into luxury condos, then that is the canary in the coal mine going the other way. Like, hey, it's kind of over.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's going up, but like way
right.
Too
but
far
these
up.
These high end restaurants closing down are like, hey, there was definitely some sort of bubble bursting. Like, hey, like people thought we're gonna have this little scene here, we're gonna create some unaffordable food. And people are going to flock to it. Maybe there was too many of them, or maybe people just really enjoy affordable food,
mm-hmm.
like entrees for under $10 or at $10,
right? Or appetizers like for $10 is what they were. They were it was
yeah,
street
or
food for
or
$10.
Like I mean, I pay $2.50 for my pints of Miller Lite at Marquis. You know, I mean
right.
that's who you're competing with.
I went to Booty's one time, and it was when Mankles and I were down there for the robot parade. Did you ever see the robot parade?
Mm-mm. I do love robots.
Wait, I'm going to make a prediction.
A robot parade?
Yeah.
It sucked.
It didn't suck. It was just... Mm. It was different from what was advertised, let me say. It was... I read a very exciting Doug MacCash...
Sort of like Booties.
I read a very exciting Doug MacCash article about how great the robots were going to be.
Oh, really? Yeah?
And
are you making fun, or
no,
did you
is,
really do that?
This is actually true.
This is not a Doug MacCash joke, y'all.
Right. And
not yet.
And then we went, and it turned out that the robots that emerged were not all that impressive, and they had difficulty actually making them go down the street. It was kind of funny.
Were they real robots?
Yeah, they were like people, like remote-controlled cars and shit. But like, and then people dressed up as robots.
Oh,
I think that people in a large crowd, so people were expecting something really big to happen because they read Doug MacCash's article.
That's so Doug MacCash also followed up with a review in December 2012, and he's the lead of this article is, "The robot parade in the Bywater Sunday afternoon was a complete dud."
Whoa. So, oh, okay.
So
good job, Doug.
Doug MacCash and I are we're now equal on the opportunity same page.
When you earn it.
Scores of onlookers clogged the sidewalks in anticipation of the mechanized sculpture parade. Some lured by my overly optimistic.
Ow, you're out, Doug. Damn. I'm sorry.
See,
I'm sorry, Doug.
I say it here. It comes in. It comes out there. That's exactly okay. What happened.
Doug made fun of Doug, so we didn't have to.
I am gonna make fun of Doug for using the word scores, which I'm sure it wasn't scores. And to be lured is like actually like, hey, there's some tantalizing steak over there. I'm going to go towards that. Or like, oh my God, that woman is so beautiful. I am lured into it. Nobody gets lured by a robot parade. That's a poor... Doug's...
No, wait.
Maybe the robots had pheromones. You don't know.
that might have been.
I was lured to
that's the only way I would accept that.
I was actually lured there for the robot parade. And
no, you were interested. Your interest was piqued, and you went there to be lured.
Yeah, okay.
There's a nuance here.
But so let me finish.
Take it from me. I have an associate's degree.
Let me finish the
video. In English.
So having been lured to Bywater for a robot parade, and standing there among the scores of disappointed onlookers, I decided very much that I needed a beer. And so we walked up the street and said, hey, maybe this location...
Here's a blogsterant.
Right.
I will go in there. Right.
So we walk in and immediately...
This looks sufficiently internet-y.
It was immediately...
I happen to have 3 bitcoins in my pocket. I bet you I can get...
Yeah, they were terrible.
A light beer by Miller.
They didn't. They
I
didn't,
would like a 100100011100. Thank you.
But they didn't. What they don't
10. Want I need a beer. 20. Go to 10.
Save 2 floppy.
Bam! That was like execute. Pascal humor or something, right?
So the
curly bracket.
Jesus fucking Christ. Anyway, they didn't want to serve us a beer. That's the fucking thing. I wanted a domestic
lager. That was
lager.
It?
No. Well, they were like shitty.
That was your whole punchline?
No, because Jeff probably went in there with his normcore style, and they didn't recognize normcore.
Yeah, they were really shitty.
Yeah. And you hadn't been in the Advocate then, so you couldn't be like...
Ah, shut up. So they were really shitty, and we wanted, like, I wanted, like, a Miller Lite to go, and they looked at me like it was from Planet Mars or something. And then Mankles ordered some kind of a cocktail from them, and it took them 20 minutes to make it.
Error. Reboot. Right.
Do y'all have slippery nipples? You should have asked them that.
So that was our
sex
terrible,
on the beach, please.
Terrible experience at Booties involved a bad robot.
Well, no one's going to miss them, I don't think.
I went there once or twice. I remember absolutely nothing about it. It is just a blank space.
And now it literally is one.
I think I drank some things and maybe ate something. I have no memory of it at all. None. It's just... Did it even happen?
I don't think anybody... Everybody is like kind of like, yeah, it's one for the good guys. Even though some people probably lost their ass and some people probably lost their jobs, which I'm sure...
Yeah. So you don't want to... You do feel
Mandy, pardon me, but hey... Restaurant servers can find a job just about anywhere.
In the restaurant business,
nobody
is really
shitty. Yeah.
Like the last thing I would want to do with my money, if I ever had any, was open a restaurant. Like it's just it's a lot of overhead and it's a lot of headache and heartache, and it's hard work for like really slim margins.
Everybody, the owners and the servers, and then but also Maurepaw, which. Everybody seemed to like Leonardo DiCaprio was there the night I was there. I thought it was okay, what? Though. Yeah.
That's cool.
But, I mean, again, I don't miss...
I went to Pesh at the same time as Carrie Russell one time.
Whoa. Felicity?
Yeah. Or Elizabeth Jennings in The Americans.
Oh, yeah. Favorite show. That is, Alli likes
celebrities
that.
Have to eat, too.
I wanted to talk to her, but I left her alone, and I'm glad I did, even though she's the best.
You know what? I would go to the joint in the Bywater, and they had great food for affordable prices, and it was cool, and it was there.
Is that still open?
When the cabs wouldn't go there, it was there. Yeah, and the girl who runs it is from Pensacola, baby, FLA.
What we need is a term for ain't there no more that applies to things that were barely even there in the first place.
Oh, yeah.
It's been there for 5 minutes.
I think I call it, last night I came up with something called a retro pop-up.
Oh, it was like...
Yeah, it's a retroactive pop-up. It's like the owners of Booties. It was like, actually, it was a pop-up the whole time. It was a 3-year pop-up.
We planned this.
I meant to do that. when they closed, you're like, I meant to do that.
Hope you enjoyed our pop-up. We popped down.
A pop-down.
Hey, you know what? Are there still pop-ups? Is that kind of over?
There's a pop-up right now on Magazine Street. But they only, it's the snowball stand, and they only sell you king cakes from Haydell's.
Oh.
So that's the pop-up.
I love that little place.
I think they
I love the ceramic figurines they give you. They are really well quality. I like the quality of them, and it's... I'm smiling just thinking about getting one.
Ceramic figurines?
They have a little story with them. They're like a Mardi Gras. One time it was Daddy Kong from the Bacchus Parade. And one time last year, it was a bunch of 6'10" stompers on a streetcar, and that was actually like a mashup.
Man, they should do the kind of figurines that are a Christmas tradition in parts of Spain. I think in the Catalonia region, where it's a pooping figurine. I have one.
Have a pooping.
All right, well,
yeah, it's like a little boy, and he's like squatting down and pooping, and it's a holiday tradition.
It doesn't come in food, does it?
Figurines and
so
stuff.
So if you get the poop in the king cake. You have
I have one of these figurines that my brother got me. I gotta bake it into a king cake this year.
Yeah, you definitely.
We're putting that in the show notes.
Do that. Pooping king cake. I'm writing that down.
Okay, well, I feel the need to move on.
You want to move on to the next thing.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about Sean Payton.
But just, I want to say one more thing about Booties, and it's just that I am very much looking forward to the upcoming Peggy Scott Laborde documentary about Booties memories.
The Bywater that was?
Yes, the Bywater that, the new New Orleans that we knew, sort of, maybe. But,
whoa.
And so Alli.
Oh, he doesn't actually poop.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a gnome.
It's a little boy.
It's a gnome. Alli has...
I like this.
Alli has,
we're going to take a picture of that and put it in the
Alli
show
has
notes.
Has returned from the other room with a garden gnome pooping.
He looks like he got surprised.
Pooping garden gnome.
He looks like he was doing it and somebody walked in on the stall. You know that look? That sheer panic when somebody walks in. And
it's called a caganer. That's right.
Yeah.
Or... I don't know how you pronounce it.
So our head coach is on drugs and had a very, somebody found him when he was peeking. And then he decided to do it. He was like, I'm not in the press conference, man. I'm doing it now. I don't care.
So we're segueing now into...
Well, was there anything
else? No, that was it. I was just... I enjoyed it.
So our head coach, Sean Payton, is staying.
Yeah.
Maybe, maybe not, according to the reporters at ESPN. And had a press conference that I myself did not see. I kind of got it told to me by Pants,
mm-hmm.
who is Jeff Skooks.
Sitting right here.
A man of many names.
People told you something.
Talking to the audience, the listeners right now. And apparently, and just by looking at it without sound, I have to say I agree with this. He was fucked up.
Oh, okay. So
breaking...
Yeah.
Sean Payton was fucked up at that press conference.
Yeah, so all week everyone...
This is speculation, I'm sorry.
Everyone expected Sean Payton to be gone. Well, not everyone. There was wild speculation that Sean Payton was gone.
Not according to Tom Payton. The Roger Clinton, Billy Carter of the fucking Payton family. He was like, Sean ain't going nowhere. And then he also said some other crazy... Like, the post above that was like... Some crazy Facebook type
I want to
shit.
See Tom Payton party with Cooper Manning.
Yeah.
That's what I want to see.
Cooper Manning, Roger Clinton, Tom Payton, and Billy... Oh, Billy Carter's dad.
So thank you to...
Is it Roger Clinton?
Roger Clinton, but Bill's
He's
fuck-up brother.
He's got to be dead, right?
No!
So
he was
dead or in jail.
Famous brothers. Like Daniel Baldwin can be there. You know,
really any Baldwin.
I wanted to say thank you
Joe
to...
Joe Bostick's brother, Jeff. You know, we could have the crazy definitely, brothers.
Definitely. I wanted to say thank you to our friend Anger Hudat for digging up Coach Payton's brother's Facebook page and sharing it all over Twitter.
Tom Payton? What the fuck is that? It is. He's definitely Cooper. He's a Payton family. Or Eli, really.
He's a magician.
He like, is?
He's a professional magician.
No, he's not.
Yes. He's Joe Bluth.
Yes, he totally is Joe Bluth.
He demands to be taken seriously.
So
who's going to believe that?
No, but Angry Hudat would dig up these, like, he'd go into the Facebook page, he'd dig up videos of Tom Payton performing magic tricks.
Oh my god, I missed the
video. Please put that in the show notes.
Oh, it's going in
so
the show notes.
So I can see it.
Tom Payton's magic tricks.
Or is it magic?
Illusions, Vargas!
If I'd have known that, I totally wouldn't have believed it, because that guy makes a living out of being full of shit.
Right.
I'm glad I didn't know that, because when I read that, I was like, I think Sean's going to stay. His brother Tom said so.
His brother Tom was a professional magician.
Professional bullshit artist.
Right.
Wow. And then Sean did stay.
So.
Yeah, because so, Tom tried to hide him in the Aztec tomb, and he got out.
Yeah.
Well, so they did. They tried. Here's what's great about this day, actually. They tried to pull this very Sean Payton and Loomis thing where they fuck with the reporters. Like, they had them all go sit out at Saints camp all day, and we're going to have a press conference at 1, and we know that you got all this shit going on, and we're going to tell you what's happening at 1. And then they didn't do anything at 1. We'll come back at 2. We'll come back
Sean
at 2.
Sean is often late for his press conference.
He always is.
I sat there with my browser open waiting on him a lot.
Right. And they, so they made him wait till 2. And then they came out at 2, and they tried so hard. I mean, Tom Benson came there, Gail Benson was there.
Whoa.
Loomis was there, and Peyton's got a little chair, and he sits at the desk.
Tom Benson was sitting there, like, opening packets of American cheese, probably, and just eating them and stuff.
Wine and ice cream.
Right.
Gail.
A little port wine cheese.
Yeah.
Yes! Yes. Wait, I thought port wine cheese only existed in the Midwest. Has it escaped our borders?
You can go to the store right now and get some. You want some?
Yes. Always.
But
shit is delicious.
So, port wine cheese. I'm writing that down.
I've never even heard of it.
You're missing out.
Anyway, they are there, and they've got all the reporters on edge, and they try to pull off this typical Saints thing where they just go, what the fuck were y'all even here for? Like, nothing's changing. Like, they try it.
I like that.
They try that, and then it doesn't really work because apparently Sean Payton is totally high.
So he was back there, like, going, tell him to go home. There's nothing to see.
Right.
When I go out there and say everything's the same as it was?
No, this is like the asshole dad who, like, spends all the time wrapping Christmas presents and stuff, but it's, like, empty boxes. He's like, ha-ha, shouldn't have gotten your hopes up, because you were so bad!
Right, right. But they couldn't pull it off.
There are dads like that?
But so it goes wrong because, and nobody, well, everyone knows that he was totally high, but the reporters don't say this, but he, like, he's completely out of it, and they start asking him questions because he's really disappointed. He's disappointed that he couldn't get out. It's pretty clear that
the word got out, maybe, and I'm just fan fictioning here, mm-hmm. that he was fucking high all the time and on Molly, as Junior Grillette's girlfriend said.
Right.
And so everyone was like, we don't want to bring that shit into our right. organization.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we don't want – the Bucks are like, we don't want Lovie Smith, and the Niners are like, we don't want this new used car salesman that we had, but we definitely don't want this guy that's high on Vicodin and Molly all the time.
Right.
And we definitely don't want to give up a second-round draft pick for him also.
That definitely all went into
compensation.
So nobody wanted to pay the Saints or him, you know, what they thought he was worth because of everything you just said. So – they just discovered, they spent all week and I guess a lot of that day learning this. So he's very disappointed. He's probably popped a lot of pills because of
my love, my
So he sits there and he goes through his whole, like, he says, the first thing he says is, I'm not going to say next question. I'm not, y'all can ask all the questions you want.
He did, because he did that on Sunday.
Yes.
They were, he was a dick to them.
And,
which is great, because I love seeing them get tortured.
And then he talked for an hour, and we were in the bar last night, and we watched this with no sound.
With no sound, which is how I like to watch.
And you could just look at his glassy eyes and his just faraway look, and his...
They looked wrinkled.
Do you think it was just bad lighting?
No, man. If you heard him, did you hear what he said? So he's talking about... He's rambling. He's talking about how, you know, my mother, when she's no longer with us... She used to like to go to the flea market and buy a lot of couches.
Okay.
Well, continue with that. Where did he end up with that?
Well, the question I think there was about free agency.
I only watched it with no sound.
But it just was weird.
And if you bought a bunch of flea market couches, where would you put them?
Well, I'll have to answer that next episode, Allie.
Then he goes into this.
Think about it a little bit.
What kind of art installation would you build with your flea market couches?
Now I'm challenged. I'll have to, I'm thinking maybe lifting one up on a crane and putting a naked mannequin on it. I'm sorry, I went off on an installation piece there.
You could put a ceramic pooping doll on the couch. Yes, that would be good.
A caganer.
So he's
out of it. And then he also says, so they ask him why he's staying, and he doesn't have a good answer because he's obviously been rejected.
The plot holes is his answer.
And so, his answer is, oh, I'm going to write a love letter to New Orleans. And he just goes on this whole, like, really, like, maudlin thing about how the boil water orders and the potholes and all that stuff seems kind of weird, but it grows on you, man.
It doesn't grow on me.
It doesn't.
And he says that if he ever had to leave New Orleans, he would really miss going to a restaurant and having all five of the waiters deliver all five of your entrees in a synchronized fashion.
Okay, well, that is nice.
If you have,
but it doesn't. It's not. It's one of those things. That's not particular to New Orleans. I'm sure that you can find a restaurant in any city that does that, or at least big cities.
Probably, I would probably agree with that.
It's like one of those things, one of those only in New Orleans things. Would you see a man walking down the street in Speedo or with a gorilla mask on? It's like, nah, that could happen somewhere else.
But I think it's a really good point about, you know, how a couple episodes ago.
I haven't seen it here either, but it's euphemistic.
Y'all remember a couple episodes ago where we talked about these love letters to New Orleans or these breakup letters with New Orleans?
That was in our pilot episode.
It was. If you want to download it, I don't recommend it. But the
one where you decide the quality of the future episodes based on that one.
Right. But anyway,
I think it's better than this one. Self-actualization.
I'm going to cut all of that out. Anyway,
no editing whatsoever. I'll walk out. I'll quit if there's any editing. I want to keep it real.
I was making a goddamn point.
Keep it real, committee, motherfuckers.
Illusions, Vargas.
I was making a point. So all of that stuff about these love letters to New Orleans, the genesis of a lot of those are, you know, this a personal disappointment and or settling on the part of the author of these letters. You know, they're like,
there was a vision of something beautiful and it just didn't work out, kind of like Booty's had. That right. might be an overreaching episode-long theme of, like, hey, I want this to be something. Oh, you disappointed me.
Yeah.
And that's why this thing isn't beautiful
anymore. Right, so Sean Payton decided that he was going to stay. Because New Orleans is wonderful, not because the Giants wouldn't give.
Right. Them. Well, that is why
it was right. But his version of it is, oh, but I love the potholes, so I'm going to stay here.
It's like he's a married man. He's in this marriage. He gets some temptation from a mistress or something. It doesn't work out, and he looks at a picture of his wife and realizes, hey, I really love Janice or whomever, and right. I'm going to stick with my marriage and be a good guy.
That's what that is.
And go into it.
That's what that is.
So she'll accept me for my being on Vicodin and Molly.
And it's not because his mistress dumped him, which is what really happened.
Right. It was all, she was just trying to get him away from his wife and shit. And then she had her little booties moment where she was like, I actually don't like this guy. That's what the Giants were like. We're like, you know what? We've wanted Sean Payton for so long, and now that he's within reach, we're just like,
They looked at his embroidered jeans and they were like, no.
No.
I'm done.
Yeah. And his relationship with
Kenny Chesney.
Yeah. That is. That should have been Wait, everybody's.
Kenny Chesney broke away from Steve's Burger for half a minute to hang out with Sean Payton. Is that
Wait, you don't know the Chesney stuff?
I don't think I've heard about
Kenny
this.
Chesney has been at every Saints training camp for the last 5 or 6 years.
Oh, okay.
He gets to like run passing routes and
Lifelong
stuff.
Lifelong Saints fan Kenny Chesney.
Yes.
Well, we should have known something was wrong with Sean as soon as that they started hanging out.
As soon as that.
Well, this is a
so much Molly.
This is a joke
Kenny
on
Chesney
the college
concerts.
Football internet is that Kenny Chesney is a fan of all of the college football programs. He's a lifelong Tennessee fan. He's a lifelong South Carolina fan. He's a lifelong Florida. Like he's
the belle of the ball.
He's like the Drake of country singers. He'll put on whoever's hat and hang out with whoever.
Kenny Chesney hotline bling.
Yes.
I am going to demand that someone create that mashup.
You never poke me on my Facebook.
Right. There you go.
Yeah.
Is that a Kenny Chesney song or a Drake song?
Oh, that was...
All right.
The hotline bling.
That's going to be me.
Well, I have to admit I would have been sad if Sean would have left.
Yeah.
Because I don't know who would have replaced him, probably.
Lovie Smith.
That would have... No.
Mike Smith.
Although if Coughlin would have come here...
Mike Smith would be...
Smitty, no Smitty, no Lovie. And not that used car salesman that San Francisco...
No,
he was a pop-up
man,
coach,
Mike
that Tom guy.
Mike Sula would have been great.
The guy they were all that promoting... That would have been great. The guy they were all promoting was Doug Marrone.
Ugh.
Yeah, and again, ugh, right.
Who's that?
An NFL robot. Yeah. Just a personalityless, like, nobody.
A Saban Belichick personality?
Just like I am NFL coaching clone, Doug Marrone. Like, he's a nobody.
You might remember.
Who's the NFL coach robot?
You might remember Doug Marrone from the Fox, like, graphics. Where
he's Cletus. Right. Yeah. Doug Cletus Marrone. Yeah,
so that would have been bad.
Who the fuck is he? Like, not what is he, which I think I have a pretty good grasp on that. But where does he coach currently?
He's an ex-Tampa coach, isn't he?
He is.
I don't remember him.
No, I don't think
before
he was in Tampa.
Chuck Schiano?
No, he wasn't. I don't think he coached Tampa.
Where am I? Or, like, Buffalo?
Well, that would have been a disappointment. I'd rather have Juggy Sean.
Let's pull up Doug Marrone's Wikipedia page just for freaking accuracy here. As a coach.
Yeah, he was a Bills coach. That's right.
Yeah, he was in Buffalo. He was in Jacksonville.
Let me look at Robot.
He was the Saints offensive coordinator under Peyton from 2006 to 2008. And that's what his connection here is. And this is why all the insiders thought that he would be somebody.
All right.
Yeah, like, you don't even recognize him because you've seen him everywhere and nowhere. He is a man.
I remember Coach Bot,
Doug Marrone.
Having been offensive coordinator under Sean Payton means nothing because you don't call the plays.
I know they got Carmichael is the current one, right?
Right. Okay. And sometimes he calls the plays and sometimes he doesn't.
He is really so, know, like,
they free
I'm such a nobody that I barely...
fucking play calling with the Saints. So nobody even knows. But anyway,
doom,
so that's the...
Doom, 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 doom. That's Bad Street, y'all. No singing Bad Street when we're all three here, man. It cannot happen.
Well, you just did it, so...
I know.
Yeah, that's on you.
I know.
Quit fucking breaking your own rules.
I have a lot of things I can do with that. That joke's got legs.
So, 2016. This bit's got legs.
I'm not gonna spoil it.
Y'all
just have to listen.
And so my thought about Peyton was that he wrote a stupid love letter to New Orleans because he was on drugs.
It was my second favorite coaching press conference that I've watched without sound.
Okay.
My first favorite was a random one of Les Miles. I was at Carrollton Station watching it, and it was the one where he acted like he was bowling, and then he acted like he was like, you know how you kind of wiggle the, like, when you want the ball to go off
yes.
a certain way, you kind of like move it with your body.
Yes.
He mimicked that, but I saw it without sound, so I wasn't picking up the bowling reference. Yeah. And I just saw him kind of act, you know, how he gets real serious with his eyes. And then I just saw him kind of like wiggling across the screen and stuff.
Yes.
And I wasn't a Les Miles fan at that point, although I was shortly thereafter. And there was an LSU fan there. And I said, hey, what the fuck is wrong with your coach, man? And then he just kind of shrugged and looked at me like it was his crazy uncle or something, like a member of his family he couldn't do anything about, you know, like, eh.
That's going in the show notes, Les Miles.
See if you can find
there's a GIF
the
of
bowling.
That. I know exactly the thing you're talking about.
Is it kind of like this one?
We're looking at phones.
Alli found it.
We're looking at phones.
So it does
this
exist.
This is the famous LSU freak gif of Les Miles as Elvis doing
that. Might have been the same.
Doing the winky thing.
It might have been the same press conference.
It might be the same.
It's probably
the same. Just later he imitated bowling.
Yeah.
That will.
Go and you know,
hey, speaking of LSU, by the way, I believe in our last two episodes ago when we previewed the Texas Bowl, we said that Texas Tech had no defense, and LSU was going to kick their ass, and that's exactly what happened.
So, yeah,
because it was not the least surprising thing.
Because hottest coach in college came and said, "Hey boys, here's what we're going to do."
He did look good on that sideline.
No offense. I mean, no defense. What? No defense. No defense.
No.
Or did I just blow your fucking mind?
Well, boom.
Speaking of bowl games, we didn't do too good on New Year's Day. Me and you.
My team did way better than your team.
Sorry. Your team lost and my team lost.
Yeah.
Binary.
If you're going to go binary, then they'd...
Didn't your team get their ass whipped?
It was the...
They were never in it?
They were in it. They were only down by one touchdown at one point.
Well, so were we.
It was different points.
Well, you didn't play a hardball. If you'd have played a hardball, maybe it would have been different.
Scored four touchdowns. How many did you score?
We played...
One. Right? One.
Most of those were later in the game after Ohio State and former Florida coach Urban Meyer. Yeah, I'm going to claim him all of a sudden because someone's talking shit. So I'm going to be like, he's a Florida lost. Gator. He learned everything in Florida.
Florida lost, and Florida's old coach beat Notre Dame. That's the story?
Yeah. Well, okay. I think we lost even worse because we lost to Harbaugh.
Yeah, my that sucks. I just knew that there was angst on Twitter.
Notre Dame lost because they were basically playing their third string because we've had every single person get injured on our team.
Oh, okay. So. It wasn't because they weren't trying. It was because
everybody was injured.
Okay.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
We'll get them next time.
Sure.
Maybe.
Whatever.
I don't know.
Football's over.
Rudy. I want to make note of a little quirky thing that happened this year is that we thought we were going to lose our coaches and then we didn't.
Both LSU
we got swerved
Saints.
Twice this year. That's a wrestling term.
Yeah, there were two.
Swerve. It's a wrestling term.
Swerve.
Look it up.
It's what I tried to tell. Well, I don't want to spoil Star Wars, so never mind.
LSU almost lost their coach. And then the Saints almost lost their coach.
And didn't.
But they had to sacrifice Rob Ryan in order to keep him. Is that what happened?
Yeah,
like
but,
that.
I mean, really. I don't think the defense is any different before or after Rob Ryan.
Yeah, there's some analysts just,
have
tried to see, you know, what the difference is. But I don't really think
no,
that you're
going
to know
until
next year. So we'll see.
Especially sports analysts.
Yeah. I'm almost as optimistic about the Saints next year as I am about John Bel Edwards. I think that maybe...
Who are you?
I think that... Well, I've said all year that this is... Either Sean Payton is a total drug-addled burnout, which is true.
Yes.
I think you were right about both things.
Right. Or they have a two-year plan to rebuild the team, and they always have a chance when...
They just need another Friedman unit.
Yes.
To turn it around.
That's exactly right. Another 6 months.
He's crushing up his Viking, and he's like, I got a good play for y'all next. Hold on a second.
We're gonna
call the Drew Brees bootleg on this play. That's for you, Jeremy Hebert. I won.
I'm just saying they're gonna
$10 off Jeremy Hebert because there was not a single Drew Brees bootleg touchdown this year. If he would have run a bootleg for a touchdown, I would have lost $100. Since he didn't, I won $10.
That was a prop bet.
And there were so many times when like we were, I was like, oh shit, I'm about to lose $100 because they were like right on the goal line, and he handed it off, and Ingram or whatever ran into the pile and got tackled, and then you just see like Drew Brees like clearly just could have easily run into the end zone, but didn't. And I'm not going to make the bet next year, Jeremy. You had your chance.
It's not.
Hey, we just broke some news.
No bet next year.
Man,
I had a good year betting.
I know you did. I know you did. I owe Lance a lot of money because we had a stupid bet this year that didn't go so well for me. But it you know, it's fine.
Yeah.
But
spreadheads coming to an. I'm going to sell that for $10 million. I'll explain it some other time.
Maybe we'll do that some other time. I'm trying to look for a way to get us out of this sports segment.
Take a break and then come back and do.
Are you not entertained?
Yeah, I think we should take a break. Go to Are You Not Entertained? And then
hold on. Let me do it like this. Are you not entertained? Turn the reverb.
I enjoyed it.
And we'll try not to.
Robot not parade scores of fans.
Okay, so Lance will
lured there. Sorry.
Are you done?
Yes.
All right. So we're done with this. We'll be back in a minute.
We fired our cannon till the barrel melted down. So we grabbed an alligator and we fought another round. We filled his head with cannonballs and powdered his behind. And when we touched the powder off, the gator lost his mind. We fired our guns and the British kept a-coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run. On down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.
Are you not entertained?
Welcome back to the Hunker Downcast, and we are going to go right into our next recurring segment. Are you not entertained?
I don't think that's how it goes.
Are you not entertained?
Okay, that's how it goes, I guess.
Yeah.
That was good.
Yeah. So what I did
this week. This is the part where we talk about what we did this week.
Are you not entertained?
Yeah, all right. So what did you do this week, Lance?
I had 24 oysters on New Year's Day while I watched Ole Miss make fools of Oklahoma State
they did.
In the Sugar Bowl playing trick plays, and it was great.
Yeah, man, they threw a backwards pass to Laramie Tunsil.
It was an entertaining game to not have any dog in the fight. It was fun to watch. It was like, oh, these guys are getting played.
I don't care for Ole Miss, but that was fun.
I watched it at Frankie Johnny's on Chapultepec. Juan, the excellent oyster shucker there, shucked us some oysters. I ate them on crackers this time, which I don't normally do. I usually just slurp them on down. Yeah. But I think I felt as though I needed some carbs.
Sure.
Instead of just straight, I guess oysters are straight protein.
Sure.
So, but they were big, good, salty.
It's a big deal.
And pretty amazing.
It's a big deal to have oysters on New Year's Day.
Yeah,
I didn't have any this year.
My tradition has trickled down to just doing that.
I wanted
to keep it alive, you know, keep it going. Got a pearl in one of them. Yeah, and it was white.
That's a good omen.
And round, yeah.
All right.
And then the next day in the French Quarter, I made sure, like when I was walking, and I do this a lot to sports fans. I'm like walking with my friend and I see one because, you know, those Oklahoma State colors are like fucking hunter orange.
Yes.
So you can't miss those fuckers. And I'll like walk by and I'll see them like way ahead of me and they're not paying attention to me at all. And I just make sure when I like walk past them, I like look at my friend and be like, yo, man, Oklahoma State looked like fools last night, bruh. And then I just kind of keep walking and stuff and kind of see them like go.
Wow.
It's fun.
You just like to deflate their...
Well, I mean, after a while, they see... I mean, the people around in the French Quarter, when you're there a lot, they kind of start to become like shrubberies and stuff. They become... There's a certain dehumanizing thing to them when you're just around them so much. And so many of them are repetitive caricatures of previous people.
They're in uniform to begin with.
Yeah, yeah. They're
wearing the same
color. That helps.
Very familiar with their mob behaviors. So you know exactly.
And the Oklahoma State people weren't particularly mean. They weren't Alabama fans.
Right.
But
we weren't on a Royal Street advisory system high alert.
We were not on one of those. It's particularly fun to fuck with visiting teams that are playing the Saints, though.
I've enjoyed that over the years.
The Falcons.
I've enjoyed going to the quarter after the games and talking to the people.
You learn
what they're like from others, or at least what the football fans are like from other cities. I've always enjoyed that.
The Steelers are always great when they, because I fuck with Big Ben, and his history.
You know who the worst?
A lot. I'd be like, you know, the thing I love about, I used to like be really mean to him, but now what I just say is like, I see some of them coming, and I'll be like, you know what I love about, no, I can't say it.
Okay.
The thing I love about Drew Brees is that he's a really stand-up guy and that he's never raped anybody.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And then they go, oh, particularly the ones wearing Roethlisberger jerseys.
Well, that would be the person you would target for that.
Yeah. Yeah. And then they go, and they get all kind of, and I'm like, sorry, guys. You do wear the jersey.
Well, you did rope them in.
Agree or nice disagree job. With, you know, whatever happened.
So
you don't got to, it's like the guys who fucking, you know, agree or disagree with the statues. You don't got to go out there on Facebook and talk about it. You don't got to sue anybody over it.
Like,
you don't got to double down on your support of this fucking asshole.
Yeah,
you can be a Steelers fan without buying a Roethlisberger.
Right, yeah. Get a Deuce Staley jersey. Get a fucking Hines Franco Ward. Harris.
I like
Hines Ward. Yeah, that's a stand-up guy. Everyone loved Hines Ward.
Yeah.
I like the way
you're wearing a Roethlisberger jersey. You're just saying, like, hey, I'm a dick.
Jerome Bettis. Go Irish.
I like the way this
went. It's another way to heckle fans in the French Quarter.
No, I enjoyed the way it went from, you know, it's fun to meet people from other cities and talk to them about what their team is like. And then
said that.
I know. Okay. You immediately went to, yeah, it's I like to really.
Yeah, well, it's fun to fuck with people and their tribalism.
Right.
Okay. Even though I myself am a tribalist for the Saints and the University of Florida.
Yeah,
but if you went to another city to watch a Saints game, you would totally expect to get fucked with.
Yeah, but what would they fuck with me about? Oh, like Katrina? That would be a dick move. But yeah. Katrina is not something that, like, it passively happened to New Orleans.
That still happens.
Ben Roethlisberger.
It's still, yeah.
By the way, that still happened.
I know it still happened. I think they did it for LSU, right?
No.
Unless you got fucked with.
Just just in the last Saints game, you can go like and look at the Falcons Twitter people, and they're still making Katrina references.
But that's not.
It's like.
That's not like the same thing as wearing a Roethlisberger jersey. Like, you know, he fucking acted a little shady and now is continuing to act like nothing happened and was a huge dick about it. And then you're just going to wear his jersey?
Same with Tampa and Jameis Winston. Oh, we're going down a very unfunny road.
Yeah, okay. Well,
I also saw the Fun 40 Fellas with you last night. Oh, happy Mardi Gras!
I wasn't invited.
Yeah, you were on that group text.
You were totally in the group text of that.
Oh, okay.
You were not invited.
I didn't go.
You didn't go. That's exactly.
I like the way you tried to turn yourself into a victim there.
It wasn't, though.
I'm not going to go uptown if I don't have to. Sorry.
Who can blame you?
The Funny 40 Fellows ride, it's just Peggy Scott Laborde and her friends on a fucking.
Who is hot, who I have a crush on.
Jesus Christ. On a fucking streetcar.
Especially in her wig.
Varg's really into scrunchies. So.
I didn't know that.
I have a scrunchy ball somewhere.
Wow.
From the 90s.
Like Pee Wee Herman's rubber
band.
It's
in a footlocker in my house in Algiers. Yeah. It's padlocked, so no one will steal the scrunchies back. I used to steal scrunchies in the 90s.
Scrunchies. Wow!
Yep. Maybe next week's show notes, you can check it. It might be in there.
Scrunchy ball. I'm
writing it. And the ladies that I would hang out with would get together and be like, how are we going to stop them from stealing our scrunchies? And then I would padlock them like to my
How
bed.
Did they stop you?
Well, before I got the padlock, they would just steal them back, which made sense.
Man, no wonder you have a thing for Peggy Scalaboard.
Yeah.
Oh, is that what we're talking about?
And I saw the Fun Funny Fellows, and it was great. There was a real Mardi Gras-like atmosphere out there. There was kids playing. So somebody got shot in the leg.
No, nobody got shot. But,
you had something to say about the Fun Funny Fellows.
Yeah, I don't
even
know what the fuck we're talking about.
Hashtag PHPHPH.
Yeah. So the Funny 40 Fellows is, it's a nothing. It's like, you're like, hey, I'm going to come and watch. And
I knew it was a nothing when I came.
And do your ritual with you. And
I want to hang out with you and Minkelberg.
Yeah, Michaels and I go out and watch them come by because we live convenient to the streetcar route. And it's a neat way to welcome the carnival season. Like, you go out and it's this kind of mysterious thing that's coming down the street. You don't know when it's coming because there's nobody tracking it. So you have to kind of stand
there. I was
going to
ask if there was a tracker.
No, there's no tracker. This is the last thing.
There's a little streetcar that goes in front of it with a little thing on it with the lights and stuff.
You kind of know when it's coming, but it's not. It's like the old days where you had to use the force to kind of know when the parade is coming.
Yeah, I remember those. Although, fuck that.
Even I remember those days.
Yes.
It wasn't that long ago.
It wasn't that long
ago. I'm like, fuck that, though. I don't care about nostalgia. If that parade's fucking 2 hours away, I need to know if I need to go piss, get another beer. I'm not going to make the ferry home.
Mm-hmm.
I need to know that shit.
Yeah, no, I'm not a Luddite about this at all. But it's a fun experience to go out there and wait for the carnival to arrive, you know.
And Peggy Scott LaBorde, and then who knows what other luminaries are on there, because they're all in masks.
Yeah, the same assholes. Yeah, the same people. But
I know a couple people who were on it, and they are decidedly not assholes.
Who were they?
People from my Crew de Voo crew. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wait, hold on. My former, the oldest crew of Crew de Voo?
Mm-hmm.
The one that takes up three blocks sometimes because we move too slow?
Because we got, yeah.
I don't even know if I'm still in that. I bet you if I ponied up the money, they'd be like, yeah, you come on back in here.
I don't know. Maybe.
Have they been saying, fuck that, Lance? We're glad he's out of
there? No, there's always a waiting list of people.
Yeah?
I don't know.
I already showed out on that float day, though. I made my presence now.
My question about that is that I know that the current iteration of the Funny 40 Fellows is actually a split off of the old Crew of Clones. Which is what originated Crew de Voo. We'll have to find out from someone what the actual, you know, the argument was that split up the Crew of Clones.
I think it was the midichlorians.
Okay. I knew it! God damn it! I was waiting for a joke to make on that. I think Jedi Master Sidious. They were bred...
Don Marshall.
Now we have to talk about prequel... plot lines and stories, and that's convoluted. Like,
no,
like,
it was mostly a shorthanded way of saying I don't fucking know because
I know you don't know
because I was born in the '80s and I don't know.
I know you don't know.
Well, I chose to not party last night because I did not go out and see the parade. I stayed home and watched a show on Netflix called The Great British Bake Off.
This is her. Are you not entertained?
Yeah. I've been catching up on Netflix.
That is. Wait, say it again. What you did.
I stayed home and watched a cooking show called The Great British Bake Off.
Jesus. I am not entertained. I think the answer is no.
Okay, well.
I mean, I've seen those British cooking shows, and they have their value to put you to sleep and stuff.
This one was like Top Chef, but it was with amateur bakers, and it had all of the great elements of Top Chef, which is to say you got to watch a lot of fun people bake fun things. But none of the terrible things, including gimmicks, artificially low time limits, dumb competitive drama, and all of that. It was lovely.
I'm down with that.
And I really enjoyed it.
I'm so tired of competitive cooking.
Right. It is that's dumb. Why it's I just... really enjoyed this, because even though it was like objectively competitive, it was still almost cooperative and everyone was supporting each other and... It was
fuck
very,
that.
It was very lovely.
It was lovely.
I loved it.
So, okay.
But I got was
still it was still a competition, though.
Yeah, it was.
But in that British sporting way.
Yes.
Did they make donut like holes?
No, they made...
no.
I watched three
donut
episodes.
Donut balls, bro.
There was a breads episode, a biscuits episode. Which
of course, there was a...
different things.
There was a chips episode. There was a bangers and mash episode.
It's a baking show. God
there was
it.
A fried cod episode. There was a pea soup episode.
Chicken tikka masala. Yeah, which is a British dish.
That's exotic. Chicken masala.
Dinner roll episode.
Yeah, there was tea. There was a tea episode. It sounds,
The first one was cake, and they all made Victoria's sponge.
I can't believe we forgot about cake. How did we forget cake and that old fucking thing?
Yeah, except they called it sponge the whole time. Sponge.
There was a haggis. There was a haggis episode.
Good bake. Sponge.
A stout beer episode.
It's good.
Well, goddamn, now I'm going to check it out.
Who's entertained now?
Yeah, yeah, I'm with you now.
All right. Oh, wait, I forgot my favorite part. One of the there's two judges. One is named Mary Berry, and the other is named Paul Hollywood.
Paul what?
Paul Hollywood.
Hollywood, Hollywood, Hollywood?
Paul Hollywood.
And Marion Barry?
Mary Berry.
Oh, okay, different person.
Mary Berry.
Mm-hmm. I'll have to tell Romy about that, because she loves British cooking shows.
Oh,
the Two Fat Ladies is one of her
she
favorites.
She would love it. Yeah. She would love it.
Although she does watch them to, like, she uses them like Xanax. Like, she watches them, and then, like, within 20 minutes, she just falls asleep.
Man, I watched this one to get the rage of watching Making a Murderer out of my head.
Oh!
And it did the trick. I mean, it didn't. It wasn't like a salve. I just needed to like not be further enraged by our completely lackluster criminal justice system for another night.
Right, in a row. Right.
And so I switched to baking shows, and it was great.
I too have been watching Making a Murderer, and I don't know if I found myself outraged as much as it was like, yeah.
Are you not outraged?
Well, to any of our listeners who were like, I don't know, I'm a little put off by the accents in Making a Murderer, and now you're listening to the Hunker Downcast and listening to me, I'm very sorry.
Oh, yeah. His dad definitely had an accent.
All of them!
All of them do, but the dad had one particularly.
I was fascinated by...
This is some TV show you guys are
It's a Netflix documentary that takes place in Wisconsin, and it was fascinating to me because there's this whole range of up north Great Lakes accents, ranging from kind of like a... almost like a Fargo-ish Minnesota accent, mm-hmm. which the Avery family has, for sure. And they're... they're like lower class poor people, and then if you listen to the politicians and the cops, they have more of like a normal kind of like what my accent is like, just like a normal, I don't know, normal accent. Like it's more
you have a normal
Southern or something.
Normally,
it's
abnormal.
Not quite as Minnesota-ish. So
more of your standard abnormality.
I don't know, but maybe other people just heard one accent, but I heard like a full spectrum of Wisconsin-ish shit in there.
Your Midwestern ear was like...
she knew her Harvey accent from her Chalmette accent as it relates to...
more like, I don't know, kind of like how I moved here and I started being able to tell the difference between like Alabama and Tennessee and Mississippi.
No, these things exist.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's not a...
it was neat.
I can tell Jeremy Hebert from...
Florabama Chad.
That's right.
Hell yeah. You know that panhandle, man. I can snap into it just like that. Because there's a difference between Southern and redneck when it comes to accent.
Oh,
Hotel buffet. You got to put that stress on the first syllable. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
I can't wait for Florabama Chad to make his first appearance.
He's going, man, I'm going to try and squeeze him in at some point.
Yeah, this carnival season.
Chewbacca's.
Coming at you.
He only exists on Chewbacca's night, and I'm going to be dressed as Voltan from Flash Gordon that night, so I'm going to bring the shirt and the glasses.
I'm really looking forward to that, Varg. I just got to tell you that that's going to be really great.
Man, I'm telling you, people underestimate Chad. He's a good guy now. He is in tune with the social issues of the time, but people don't think... he is because of the way he looks and talks. He gets judged. Prejudice is put on him by those Bywater hipster residents.
Should I describe Florida?
We'll talk about it during the Mardi Gras episode. We'll talk more. Maybe Florida Child come in.
Okay.
Sit in. I feel his specter here now.
So we'll... we'll put off describing Florabama Chad to the audience.
Our first guest.
Okay.
Oh, God.
It'll come later.
That's like a real radio show where I'm like, excuse me, Chad, I need to sit back down in my seat. Well, hold on a second, Lance. Now, hold on. No, Chad, I need to get back in there.
Let's do that.
He sounds kind of like Dabo Swinney from Clemson. Is he really into Jesus?
Oh, no. Now, Chad believes in humanism.
Oh.
Chad is a humanist. He believes that all religions...
he's the only humanist are just in the entire state of Florida.
It's true, but people don't think that. They judge him. They judge him by his appearance.
Yeah, I feel like we should put this off till later.
Definitely.
I'm looking forward to it.
Chad's going to come in.
That's coming this carnival season.
Wow.
I'm looking forward to carnival season. We were entertained just like Lance was by going to the 40 Funny Fellows We got to stand out on St. Charles Avenue, and it was great this year because it actually felt like a real parade was coming. There were a lot of people out there.
We were thinking about next year maybe bringing some ladders.
Yeah. It's just for the just to have them.
Just for fun.
I thought about running back in the house and grabbing the stepladder just because.
But I don't know if everyone will be in on the joke. Like, they, like, I'm sure someone will drive by, see the ladders, and be outraged. Yeah. Instead of going, oh, those guys are making a joke.
But
you It'd probably be me, to be honest.
Like, they're driving down the street and they're outraged at something, and then they see the ladders and they're like, oh, that's what I'm going to be outraged
at. Oh, wait, no, it wouldn't be me because I wouldn't be driving uptown.
Right, you wouldn't be uptown.
Yeah. But what we did this year is we brought a lot of beer and we stood out there and we waited for the streetcar to come, and it came and it went. And then we continued to stand on the neutral ground.
We doubled down.
And drink beer and wait for it to come back, and it came back. And what... What the epiphany? The epiphany that I had was
on
that,
epiphany.
Right, was that you can at any time just go stand there on the neutral ground and drink beer all night,
and everyone just thinks it's no big deal.
Right,
right.
That, but I'm like, why don't we just do this all the time? And I think that's what we're going to do in the future.
I think I see that on the Claiborne neutral ground a lot.
Right.
Yeah.
You're right.
It's like you're discovering something that's already been discovered.
Once again, yeah. I'm way behind a thing that it actually exists in the first place.
Yeah, you're being a millennial, dude.
No, I'm aspiring.
You're like, a little Columbus, like going, oh, wow, look, you can just drink on the neutral ground all the time. I'm like, bruh.
Dear, you've been at Claymore and Napoleon, right? I just discovered something new about you today.
Actually, I think it's a...
You bring some milk crates...
It's a pretty good picture of where my ambitions lie anyway. Like
that is good.
I'm gonna someday I'll have the time to go stand out there and drink all day. Or I'll go live under the bridge. Someday I'm living under the bridge.
Yeah, I got those. I have a beyond heroin / very powerful hydrocodone pills.
Yeah, I've heard this.
A little rascal
like Sean Payton
and an AR-15. Yeah. I just wanna roll around my neighborhood high on fucking poppies. With an AR-15 and a little
You
rascal.
Want a gun, too?
And yeah, oh yeah. Okay. You know, because somebody will jack you up if you just... The first two, you will get robbed. You need the third part of the equation.
Okay.
A good guy with a gun on drugs. And my buddy Mike, who brews beer, is also going to do it with me. So
okay.
Yeah. It's not just me being crazy.
Oh, no. So a drunk guy with a gun on drugs.
No, he's going to be on heroin, too. Or poppies, or hydrocodone that we snort up, or I don't know. We're going to have that poppy buzz. You know,
write down drunk guy with a gun on drugs.
A good drunk guy with a buzz. Or a drunk good guy with a gun.
Yeah, something like that.
You can choose the first quantifier if you want.
Got it.
I think drunk good guy with a gun. What's better than a bad guy with a gun? Just a drunk good guy with a gun.
If you can't take
still over. Still better, right?
If you can't
Hey, speaking of people with guns, I also played laser tag this week.
Ow, yeah, I remember you telling me that.
I was going to say, if you can't take over the Ranger
station.
How
are you going to include watching a British cooking show in the Are You Not Entertained segment over playing laser tag? That's the best thing.
Yeah, you went with that.
It could be the most entertaining thing in the history of this segment.
I guess. I mean, it was laser tag. Like,
it's, how many people did you laser tag, if that's a verb?
I didn't do very well because I haven't played
You laser lack the tag. Killer instinct.
I haven't played laser tag since, I don't know, like 1998 or so.
Did you have an AR-15 laser tagger?
Or? I had so we went to this place in Elmwood, and you can Google it, laser tag Elmwood, and find it.
There's a laser tag in Elmwood,
and it's set up to look kind of like a ancient Mayan ruin.
With Hell lots yeah! Of, Get you in the mood.
And it's dark, and there's black lights and neon and lasers and mirrors and stuff.
An Aztec.
This is where Coach Engineer Pat took you.
We went to play laser tag with our friend. It was his birthday. Oh. And so there were a few other people there. So there were like, let's say like 6 to 8 people.
Nice.
And you're on teams and you each wear a vest that has the gun attached. And you have to use the gun with two hands because you have to like cover up the sensor. So it keeps you from being able to like, you know, lean
Bounce
one hand around and like kind of do blind shots.
Oh, so you can't do like transporter type shit where
no,
you're like spinning.
You can't do like Jason Statham things.
Oh, that sucks.
So
I am not entertained by that.
So you have to hold two hands on it, and there's like ramps, and there's a tower that you can hold and defend. If you
Hell
really
yeah!
Want. It was, I gotta say.
Did you get in the tower?
I did.
Hell yeah.
I had a lot of fun.
Did you pop some caps in some motherfuckers while you were up there?
I tried. I mean, they can shoot back at you,
and
too.
And then you get so, shot like, in the tower?
Yeah, then because you have a sensor on your gun, too. So, like, if you get, you can get hit on your gun. So you can't just, like, you know, it's like if you cover up your vest and, you know, you're fine.
Pew, pew, pew.
Yeah. So it was.
Can you storm the tower? Can you just, like, bum rush it?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Totally.
You can. I think I want to go to laser tag. Laser tag owes you a free game because you just sold the fuck.
Hunker Downcast laser tag edition.
Field trip to laser tag.
Yeah, I think it would be really fun.
We could do an on location episode sometime. The streetcar tracks of St. Charles.
We'll put it. We'll each record like a voice memo on our phone in like a phone mic while we're running around, like breathing. Right.
I see Alli up ahead of me. I'm about to shoot her. Oh, I got shot.
Damn it, Mark.
I'm dead, y'all.
Yeah.
Okay. Where did this land? We landed on laser tag. But anyway, so that is going to do it for our United Entertain. We are going to come back and finish up with our concluding segments.
Recipe Minute and the Jive Wire.
No. I can do it. I got it right here.
We'll do it live.
Okay.
Tide goes in, tide goes out.
All right, no, wait. No,
never a miscommunication.
Right.
You can't explain that.
This week's Jive Wire is brought to you by Magnolia Builders, because we build it better. This week...
He did build it better.
This week, Terriblicity hosts Frankie Pecun at 9.
Oh, we're going right into the Jive Wire.
Lawrence Lounge has Hazy Day Popeyes at 10.
It's fucking happening right now.
At Fitbits, you can hear Blood Splenda at 8.
I like Blood Splenda.
Molly's Irish Cooter hosts the Whistle Biscuits at 9. The Country Club hosts Bro and the Totally Straights at 10. Shake and Bakes has Gutter Gravy at 11. Frenchman Tourist Trap hosts Greasy Gree-Gree at 5. Aunt Lorraine's hosts the Black Professionals at 9.
They're smooth.
The Tyler Bridge Lounge hosts the White Dad Blues Experience at 8.
That is the opposite of smooth.
Fat City Gras hosts...
Engineer Pat's in that band.
The Molly Cat Donuts at 10.
Mm.
The Bywater Space Place hosts the Doug Cash Money Spillionaires at 11. The bar formerly known as the Smoky Bar features Bike Germs at 9.
Watch out for that.
The Pink Elephant hosts Alluvial Chicory at 10. One-Eyed Jackson's hosts Brain Eating Abita at 6. It's an early show. The Lease Better Bank be. Bar features the St. Anne Sharts at 11. And Booted Booties hosts Artisanal Vapes at 10.
Also, the Steamboat Queenie features Cali Calliope at sunrise.
At sunset. That's kind of implied. Steamboat Queenie always features Cali Calliope.
The tourists don't know that.
That's true.
Cali Calliope's always on the Steamboat Queenie.
At sunset, sunrise, if you... buy her a couple drinks at the end of her gig.
Dang.
I'd like to thank friend of the show, Kevin Allman, for his submissions to the Jive Wire this week. To get your gig into the Jive Wire, please submit.
Please email your gig to thehunkerdowncast@gmail.com. This Jive Wire is brought to you at the top of each odd hour by Magnolia Builders. So now get out there, support...
and enjoy
some live local music.
There you go.
We did it.
With I met that, him in the swamps down in Dagobah, where it bubbles all the time.
Like a giant carbonated soda. S-O-D-A soda.
You ever heard that?
All right. This is Alli. I've got a recipe minute for everybody real quick. So let's go. So this week, in fact, tonight, I made a winter time dish that I really like making. It's a baked pasta dish, and it's usually made with broccoli rabe. Tonight I made it with spinach. But basically,
broccoli spinach.
You boil a spinach pound rob. Of a really chunky pasta, something with a lot of like ridges and stuff, so that it sticks out from the pan eventually and bronzes in the oven.
Bronze pasta.
So you boil that, and then you boil your broccoli rabe or your spinach with the pasta, and you drain them both together. And in another pan,
Keep going.
In another pan, saute some about a pound of Italian sausage, and then remove that to a plate. Take the drippings, add some butter, add some flour.
Gotta have butter.
And then stir that up, slowly add some milk, and make a nice bechamel. And then, then in your mixing bowl, you've got your pasta, your greens, your sausage, and then you make this bechamel, and you add salt and pepper, and you can add some garlic if you want, and all that. And then,
was there garlic in it?
No, not because it's...
If you want, there can be, though.
Yeah, there can be, okay. Sure. And you pour the bechamel in it, and then you cut up some mozzarella... Throw that in there, like a brick of mozzarella.
Yeah.
Cut that up in little squares. Throw that in there. Throw some Parmesan in there. Mix it all up. Dump it all in a pan. Bake it at 400 for about a half an hour. And then you eat it, and it's delicious.
So, we did it, and it was.
Ta-da! So that's the recipe minute.
All right. Thanks a lot for that. And I think that's probably all we have tonight. God, I hope it is, anyway.
Hopefully, we will have Frankenstein this episode into something that is enjoyable to listen to.
This was a good show. I enjoyed this one.
We're getting 2016 started off.
Yeah,
really great.
Anyway, thanks again for listening to
It seems like that episode of Happy Days where, all of a sudden there was an alien from Ork and it was Robin Williams that showed up. I was like, what the fuck?
That's not what happened on tonight.
It wasn't quite a Jump the Shark episode. It was a Mork from Ork episode. One where you're just like, what the fuck happened there?
Anyway. Tweet us at the Hunker Down or at Hunker Downcast.
Yeah, anyway, tweet our show at Hunker Downcast. Email us.
It's like that episode of Moonlighting where Bruce Willis and Cybill Shepherd were in a Shakespearean play.
It was like that one Sopranos where they went and made pancakes.
Yeah.
Can email us at hungerdowncast@gmail.com. You can
tweet Alli at Allison at Allison _Dion. You can tweet Varg at Varg Vargas.
Tweet Jeff at Skooks.
People can be contacted.
There was an episode of X-Files where they both were on the Lusitania. Remember that one?
Yep.
This is like that episode.
I like that one too. Is there any other thing?
There was an episode of Arrested Development where they were on the Queen Mary and broke away from the dock.
That was a whole season, wasn't it? If you really look at it.
Anyway, thank you and good night.
We'd like to thank everyone again for listening and have a good night.
There was an episode of Cheers when the doctors from St. Elsewhere were
join us again.
Beers in the bar.
Next week.